We are discussing about the secondary storage structure. The secondary storage devices are those devices whose memory is non-volatile, unlike the main memory that is volatile. This means that the stored data will be intact, means it will be there even if the system is turned off. So for secondary storage, something which we need to know. Secondary storage is also called the auxiliary storage, and it's quite less expensive as compared to the primary memory like the RAMs, and the speed is somewhat lesser than the primary storage, because the today's secondary storage is people are going towards the SSDs, solid state devices, but still most of us use the electromechanical type of disk, which is lesser than the RAM, which are totally semiconductor memory. So the data which is less frequently accessed is kept where? It is kept in secondary storage, while the data which is accessed by directly by the CPU is kept here. So the examples are magnetic disk, magnetic tapes, the removable thumb drives, etc. This is the disk structure if you are using the electromechanical devices, and that is the hard drives, and most of the secondary storage is in this form. So the structure of a magnetic disk, which we must understand, and how the data is kept, how it has to be accessed, because in purview of operating system we need to know all this. So there is an arm assembly. This is a spindle around which this disk moves. Then this arm assembly has a reader. This is the track, and there are number of tracks, and in one track there can be various sectors. This sector will keep or will have the data. One of these virtual is the cylinder, and this is known as the platter, and these are the arms. This is a read write head. This is a general structure of magnetic disk. So a magnetic disk, it contains several platters. As you see here, there are number of platters, and each platter is divided into circular shaped tracks. As you see here, these are tracks, and the length of the tracks near the center is less than the length of the tracks which are farther from the center. Then each track is divided into sectors. These are the sectors. The tracks of the same distance from the center, they form a cylinder. This is a cylinder. It can be a cylinder like this. A read write head, as you see here, read write head is used to read data from a sector of the magnetic disk, and the speed of disk is measured as two parts. First is the transfer rate, that is the rate at which the data moves from disk to computer. Then we have random access time, that is, it is the sum of the seek time and the rotational latency. So what is the seek time? This seek time is the time taken by the arm, this arm, to move to the required track. First of all, it has to come to track. Then rotational latency is defined as the time taken by this arm to reach required sector. So going to a particular track or finding a track is seek time, and then finding a particular sector where data is there is the rotational latency. So even though the disk is arranged as sectors, as you can see here in tracks physically, but the data is logically arranged and they are addressed as an array of blocks of fixed size. So the block can be of size 512, 1024 bytes, like this. So each logical block is mapped with a sector on disk, this sequence. So in this way, each sector in the disk will have certain logical address. We have disk scheduling algorithm. So when you are talking about a typical multi-programming system, there will be multiple disk access requests at any point of time. There can be many. So those requests must be scheduled in order to achieve a good efficiency. So disk scheduling is just, you can say, if you want to, an analogy, it is similar to process scheduling. So we have a certain disk scheduling algorithm for you. First come, first serve. So this algorithm performs requests in the same order as asked by the system. So let us take an example. The queue has the following request. With the cylinder numbers are like this. These are the cylinder numbers. 98, 183, 37, like this. So assume that the head is previously here, 56, at 56. So the head moves in the given order in the queue as given here. So first it is at 56, it will go to 98. So it will go to 98. Then 183, so it will go to 183. Then 37, it will come back to 37. Then 122, it will go to 122. This is 122. Then 14, so it has to go back here, 14. Then 124, and finally 65, and then 67. So this is how the head moves. Then we have shortest seek time first. So what happens here? The head is moving quite a lot. See, from 183, 237, it's quite a distance. Then again, going back, it is moving to here and there. So the efficiency is less. Thus, the seek time, the rotational latency, all this will be high. For that, we need some more algorithms. This is the shortest seek time first, SSTF. So here, the position which is closest to the current head position is chosen first. Again, position which is closest to the current head is chosen. So just consider the example where this disk is like this. Same example we are taking. And we are again taking that it is at 56. So the next closest to 56 is what? See here. The next closest to the 56 is 65. So it will go to 65. Then just we have to find the difference, which is difference with all these. The least difference it will go. So here, next is 67. So it will go to 67. Then the next will be 37. What we are doing, we are trying to find out the difference between where it is and the next one. Next can be any of these, which it has not reached yet. So the difference which is the least, it will be. So, next it will come 37, go to 37, then 14, and likewise. Then we have one more algorithm, scan. So, this algorithm is also called the elevator algorithm. Because the behavior you see, it is like an elevator. So, what happens? The first, the head moves in the direction, say backward or forward. So let us assume it goes backward. It will cover all the requests in the backward path. Then it moves to the opposite direction. Before it covers all the left one, then only it will go to the right one. Means it is moving backwards, so it will take off all the requests. It will go to all those sectors. Then it is going to change the direction. So then it moves to the opposite direction and then covers the remaining request in the path. So this behavior is quite similar to that of an elevator. So let us take again the same example. So we have the head at 56. So what it will do? The next one on the left is 37 and to the left is 14. Then when there is no other point it needs to go, because there is nothing between 14 and 0 and 14 here. See, nothing is there. So it will go to the nearest to 14. That is, it will go to the 65, then 67, and likewise it will call all the points in the serial manner, right? So these are few concepts related to disk and how disk work, and also certain algorithms we have seen. So thank you so much. Take care of yourself.